you ready for the word this morning? Amen. Could you please open up your Bible to Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 16. Gene and Arnold, can I ask you guys to just take this communion table and just put it over there, if you'd be so kind. Can we stand for the reading of God's word? We are in Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 16. Good catch, Denise. Hallelujah. I thought I'd pull out one of my old classic messages for Labor Day weekend. I thought, oh, it'll be quiet, everyone will be away, but the church is pretty much full on a Labor Day weekend. That's good news, amen? Praise the Lord. Philippians chapter 3, verse 12 through 16, Paul speaking in a Philippian jail cell. He may be speaking to you and I today also. It says, not that I have already attained or I am already perfected, but I press on. Somebody say press on. I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing. Somebody say one thing. One thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching toward those things that are ahead. And he says, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Verse 15, let us, as many as are mature, have this mind. And if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that you have already obtained, let us walk by the same rule and let us be of the same mind. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the ability of letting go of yesterday and apprehending the tomorrows. I thank you for our future in Christ Jesus. I thank you that your promises are yes and amen. I pray, Holy Spirit, you would open up the word of God in our hearts this morning. Transform us into the image and likeness of Christ. As we come into agreement with your word, let us be able to walk in victory and not in the futility of yesterday, but in your blessing and destiny, which is in Christ Jesus. It is in Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Okay, we're going to cut the video out of this message, so we'll be okay. I titled the message, Check Your Baggage. Check Your Baggage. As you can see, of all the baggage up here on the platform, Paul encourages the church here to live a clean life, to shine brightly, and to be innocent, to hold firmly, and to move forward. But he says, in order to move forward, there are some things in life that you need to let go of. Come on, somebody. Paul had a lot of baggage. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, you got some baggage. Make sure that's not your wife. I'm sorry. Paul was a murderer. In Acts chapter 6, he was there when they stoned Stephen. The Bible says he held the coat. Paul said, I was the chief sinner. He went around persecuting the church. Paul had some baggage. If he was going to be effective, he knew one thing, that the devil was going to bother him and harass him and say, God will never use you. Do you know what you did back there? Come on, has the devil ever told you that God will never use you because of your past, because of what you did, because of what you've been through? I'm here to tell you today, you are a new creation in Christ Jesus. God doesn't create junk. He has a plan for your life, and we as the church need to let go of our brokenness and our yesterday, amen? I was, Denise and I went out to Missouri, right? Y'all went to Houston, right? Was that a cool, was a fun trip? How was that experience at the airport, Lizzie? I mean, Philadelphia Airport, that is a trip. Woo! I'm telling you. I went there and with Denise, and we had the family, and we're going, and we get up to the counter, to United, And you know, there's about 157 people online. No wonder they tell you to get there an hour, 2 hours before. And then they have a new check-in system, but they don't tell anybody about it. There's no signs. You're supposed to figure this out for yourself. And so I'm trying to get the agent, excuse me. And I'm chasing the lady back and forth. And I know she sees me. And finally, I said, well, there's no instruction to follow the thing on the kiosk. So I go over to the kiosk, and it's in ancient Aramaic. Now, I'm going to make levity today. Can we laugh in church today a little bit? I don't want to be too serious at all times, so you don't think I have a lighter side. And so I go over to the kiosk, and it's in hieroglyphics, and I'm still lost. I'm still trying to track the lady down. And finally, I'd be able, about 20 minutes later, I'm able to figure, you guys were there, right? You understand my pain? And so about 20 minutes later, I'm able to figure everything out, and it spits out a ticket on the other side of the counter that I can't see. So I don't know if it's completed or what. And here we go again. Miss. My wife's like, shh, honey, don't lose your salvation. And so they cut, finally it prints out and she takes it and she goes, this your baggage? It's like, it's in front of me. She goes, is it over 50 pounds? I said, if it is, you better talk to my wife. And so it was 47.8, and we were cool. And she took it, and she tagged it, bagged it, and checked it. See, as the church, we don't want to be carrying around baggage in our lives. The baggage of yesterday, the pain of yesterday. Too many times as the church, we come down to the altar, and we bring our baggage to the Lord, and we say, Lord, in the precious, matchless name of Jesus, I give you my hurts, my habits, my hang-up, all of my pain, all of my brokenness. I give you everything, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. I said, what are you doing? Leave it there. Leave it there. Don't temporarily check all of your yesterdays. God wants whole people. I want you to be saved, but I also want you to be free. Not everybody that's saved is free. Uh-oh. Help me, Jesus. The Bible says this in Matthew 19. Verses 23 and 24. Jesus said to his disciples, I tell you, it is hard for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. Well, first thing you have to understand, he was not into knitting and crocheting. So the eye of the needle had nothing to do with sewing or a tailor. In that society, there would be a gate of the city. And inside of the gate, there would be a door. Do you see the door in the gate? The door is called the eye of the needle. So come on, follow me now. Jesus said, a rich man with all his stuff, baggage, cannot get through the door because there just isn't enough room, Chelsea. So what is the example in reference to? If someone was being chased on the outskirts of town and they had all their stuff, a rich man had all his stuff with him, and he gets to the gate, open the gate, it would take them 25 minutes to open the gate. So instead of opening up the gate, they would open up the eye of the needle. But Jesus says the rich man couldn't get through the door because he had too much junk in his trunk. Don't get smart. Paul says to work out your salvation. You don't earn your salvation. It's not by good works. It's by faith and grace in Christ Jesus. But you are saved for good works, which means when I am saved, there should be some fruit of my relationship with God. And I have to begin to work that out, to be proactive in my walk with Christ. Why? Because God wants to open up doors in your life that are specifically and only designed for you. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 16:9, he said, there is a great and effective door for me open in Corinth. The work has opened, but there are many who oppose me. Paul understood he was going to have external opposition and internal opposition. Don't think for one second that the devil wasn't whispering in Paul's ear, how are you going to serve Jesus? How are you going to serve God? After what you did, you're a sinner. You should be ashamed. You're guilty. You were a Pharisee. You know better. You got to be sensitive to the voices you're listening to, church. You got to be sensitive. My desire is to see people free from things that hinder them. We all have hindrances and I got no baggage. You got baggage. You got baggage. I got baggage. We all got baggage. It's what we do with it that counts. We all have a past. There are two types of baggage I found out in Philadelphia. There is baggage that you check that needs to be weighed, and there is also something called carry-on. The carry-on has to fit under the seat, or it has to go above in the compartment. It doesn't have the weight of this. Here's the deal, folks. God wants us to take our baggage of our past and convert it to a carry-on. All the problems and pain from the past becomes my ministry toolbox that I can help other people with. Oh, man, come on. Who better to help someone with drugs and alcohol than someone who has defeated that? Who better to help someone who has been through a divorce than someone who has had the victory in that part of their life? Or cancer, when someone would come to Jose and say, oh, I got this bad report. He says, I'm going to bring you to the altar. Why? Because it doesn't define Jose, but it refines his ministry to let him know that he's more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. And now that becomes his carry-on baggage. It's not weighing him down. It's part of his ministry toolbox. See, your past, Jesus wants to use your pain. Uh-oh. God wants to convert our old habits, hurts, and hang-ups in order for us to serve him opportunistically. Let's look at some baggage. You ready? You want to check out some baggage today? What do we got in here today? Look at that. La familia. Anybody have any family baggage? Anybody come from a dysfunctional family? I got my own dysfunction, okay? You don't have to, I'm talking to me. I was a kid, I was embarrassed. I was like, oh my goodness, they are not my family. And I said, how am I ever gonna amount to anything with this crew? We all have family baggage. Go to Thanksgiving, go to Christmas, go to Easter dinner. You'll find out real quick. Maybe you grew up in a house that was semi-dysfunctional. Maybe there was abuse in the home. Maybe it was a single-parent home. Some of these items, folks, have the ability to sabotage your current walk with Christ if you don't deal with them correctly. Uh-oh. Sometimes we have a checklist of past hurts when it comes to family. Oh, there's Cousin Mary. You know what she did to me? Oh, there's Uncle Bruce. Oh, my goodness. I can't stand him. He blows the cigar smoke and I can't stand him. I don't want to sit next to him at Thanksgiving. See, when we don't check this baggage, it could damage our relationships. Jesus wants us to walk in forgiveness and reconciliation so we're not baggage handlers. Do you understand? In Mark 3:21, Jesus' own family told him he's esta loco. Read what the Bible says. When his family heard about this, about Jesus doing all the miracles and all the different things he was doing, they went out to take charge of him, for they said, he my son, my brother, his family says he's out of his mind. Now, if Jesus had some dysfunction in his family, you can rest assured that you and I will come across some moderate dysfunction. Maybe before you got saved, you had some unforgiveness on your heart, or maybe even played the blame game. Oh, I can't forgive Uncle Joe. You don't know what he did to me. Well, God doesn't ask you. He requires, in fact, in the Bible, he commands you to forgive. Well, I don't feel like forgiving. Well, God didn't, it isn't based on how you feel. It's based on the word of God. Peter, 70 times 7, which means continual. Not if they're willing to accept it, but if you're willing to allow the Holy Spirit to minister forgiveness unto you, then why should we hold on to bitterness and unforgiveness and not forgive those people in our family? Well, it's his fault. Maybe this healing that needs to take place in our hearts. Unforgiveness and bitterness sabotage our relationships, as we see in the Bible. You know, the Bible is full of dysfunctional families. Look at Jacob's family, dysfunctional. Oh my goodness. Joseph's family, dysfunctional. What about the father of our faith, Abraham? Genesis 14, him and Sarah, they go to, they're going to meet the king of the north, and he says, honey, when we get there, you tell them you're my sister. Wait a second. The Bible says he's the father of our faith. And he tells his wife, you're going to lie. Because if they know I'm your wife, they're going to kill me and take you. So listen, here's how we're going to do it. You're going to tell a lie, and you're going to tell them you're my sister. That's how we're going to run this. Come on, Abraham. What's the story here? The Bible is full of dysfunctional families. But what about Moses? He sees an Egyptian soldier beat up a slave, and he turns around and he kills the soldier, except he leaves his big toe sticking out of the sand. And he goes and gets banished for 40 years in Midian, where he meets Jethro and his wife. And then, to say that, God gives him the Ten Commandments. He comes down the mountain, they're having a party, and he smashes the Ten Commandments. And God says, get back up here. I got to make you another set. God probably said, I had it up to here with this guy. Oy vey. And then he says, Moses, speak to the rock. What does he do? He takes out the stick and he beats the rock. You Israelites, bam, 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 bam. God says, Moses, I told you to speak to the rock. What was Moses' problem? Anger. Thank you. Oh, how do you find that out? You just go back to Genesis 27 when Jacob was giving out the blessing to the Levitical priesthood, and he said, you guys are going to have a bad temper. Anyway, Hebrews 12 and 1 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles us. And let us run the race with perseverance marked out for us. The church, brothers and sisters, needs the healing power of the cross. We need the closeness of Christ in our lives. We need the word of God to bring healing to our lives. Then, and only then, God can heal us from our past family baggage. Right? Amen? What about this one? Financial baggage. Anybody got credit card debt? Huh? Let's see. I got Visa. I got MasterCard. I got Home Depot. I got Kohl's. I got Boscov's. The Bible says the borrower is slave to the one who lends. Maybe you made some mistakes. Ran up some credit card debt. Come on, we all made mistakes when we were younger. We've all made some mistakes. Maybe you made some bad investments. We've all been there. Folks, we need to teach the next generation how to be good stewards of God's money. Amen? Luke 14:28, Jesus said, suppose Some of you want to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money? It's the principle of counting the cost before you do something. Proverbs 17:16 says, "Why should fools have money in hand to buy wisdom when they are not able to understand?" When I was young, I had a paper route. Anybody ever have a paper route? Hallelujah. And then I rode the butcher bike for the neighborhood butcher and did the deliveries. My nickname was Pork Chop. Go ahead, laugh. That's okay. Good laugh. Good. See what I get for sharing my heart? I worked at Bradley's. Anybody remember Bradley's in New Jersey? Bradley's? I worked at Bradley's when I was your age, Mark. Because my mom and dad worked very hard. They had a good job, and they were good workers. We had a beautiful house that we owned. I had a pool in the backyard. I had a pool table in the basement. It was the cool house to come hang out at. But I had to vacuum the pool, clean up after the dog. I had tasks to do. What do they call them? Chores? And I did them because I saw how hard my mom and dad were working to give me the things and education and the other things we had. Not everybody had what we had, so I learned the value of a dollar. Amen? And my mom and dad brought me to church every Sunday. My mom sang in the choir for 25 years. And when the plate came around, I watched my mom and dad give faithfully, even in the 70s. If we survived the 70s, come on. Remember the gas crisis? Odd and even plates? Whew. But God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. God took care of us in the good times and the bad. Amen? As I grew older, I saw my friends. We all went to work for Pepsi Cola. They all fell into massive credit card debt. They got a job, and then they got credit card debts and student loans and all of this stuff. By the way, how can the Visa and MasterCard give a college student who doesn't have a job a $5,000 credit line, John, with 19% interest? They won't even give me a card. But they'll give it. Why? Because they want to put the next generation into bondage. Right? I have a simple principle, Jorge. If you can't afford it, don't buy it. Just giving you real simple biblical principles. Why? I started my first church with $134 in New Jersey. I started my floor covering business with $64. My mother said, "You're crazy." I said, "I'm crazy for Jesus." Right? And when I opened up the church, I spent the last $12 on Dunkin' Donuts, coffee and donuts. And my mother said, "Now look at you. You have no money. I have bunny rabbits." You know what bunny rabbits are? That's it. I had nothing, nada, zilch, zero, nothing. My mother says, "What are you going to do for put gas in the car?" My father said, "You're crazy." I said, "I'm crazy for Jesus. My God will provide according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus." 3 days later, Kyle, the phone rang. It was an attorney from Dalton, Georgia. He said, "Is this Chris Dito?" I was like, "Hello?" I was like, "Yeah, this is him." He says, "This is Mr. Jones from so-and-so, Foster and Foster." He says, "Did you work for Pepsi-Cola when you were 22 years old?" I was like, "Yeah." He says, "Well, I have a check on my desk for $6,400. I was trying to get in touch with you." I said, "Say what?" I said, "I have a check for you for $6,000, $3,000 for a class action lawsuit, and then $3,400 in interest. I can FedEx it to you tomorrow." I said, "Tomorrow? About this time? Hallelujah!" I was in my room praying. I heard the FedEx guy put, where's Robert? Robert Langer here? Yeah, I heard the FedEx guy pull up. I heard the door swing open. I said, "That's my check." I heard him come up my steps. I said, "Hallelujah, Lord." I heard him ring the bell. I said, "Oh, Lord, it's payday." He came in. He handed me the check. I went into my mother and I said, "How do you like what the Lord has done now? How do you like what the Lord has done?" She said, "You're still crazy." I said, "I'm crazy for Jesus." 3 days, I rose from no gas money to $6,400. Why? Because God is faithful. God is faithful. God is faithful. As I moved from New Jersey and I married Denise and moved to New York, I had to empty out my house, the basement, the attic, the garage, the stuff. Ridiculous. And the Lord said to me, why did you buy all that? I was like, I didn't buy that. Yes, you did. He says, you buy all this stuff, Chris, you don't even need. And I thought, uh-oh. And the Lord taught me that if I don't need it, I don't need another toy. I don't need more stuff. I got more sneakers than a caterpillar. Right? How many pairs do you got? 6, 7? Amen. They say money is the root of all evil. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. Why? Because it leads to us coveting things, covetousness. Jesus spoke about covetousness in Luke chapter 16 and 17. It's wanting something that someone else has that we really don't need. I got to get the upgrade. Got to get the iPhone. iPhone 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. They'll be in your pocket forever. And they'll send out a little thing to jam you up and they'll send you right back to the store to get another one. We want to keep up with the Joneses, but the Joneses have just filed for bankruptcy. Luke chapter 19, Jesus spoke about the parable of the minas or the talents. And it's how to properly steward the things that God gives us. That's why we've done, Robert, the Financial Peace University here at Parkview. We had 22 people come out in the beginning of the year to help us be extraordinary financial stewards over the things that God has imparted to us in the kingdom of heaven. God wants to give us his wisdom. God wants us to give the wisdom to the next generation so Mr. Visa, Mr. MasterCard, don't put them in debt and they're carrying this stuff around plus college tuition, plus all that stuff, and then they're going to give them a job for $50,000 and they can't get out of bondage. Why is that? We need to teach the next generation, folks, all the lessons we've learned. Amen? How about the next one? Emotional baggage. Emotional baggage. These are caused by wounds and hurts that happen to us. I call them soul wounds. The survey shows that churches in America have the greatest transfer growth than any other churches in the world. People get hurt, they get upset, they get offended, and they just leave the church to go to the next church. The problem with that is that you bring you with you. Well, I'll just go down to Love of Christ. I'll just go to Word of Life. I'll just go to The Journey. I'll just go to White Clay Prayer. And that's okay. They're all great churches, by the way. We meet once a month on Thursday for lunch to discuss the sheep exchange program. Just so you know. The problem is you're going to go to another church and bring you with you. You're going to bring all those hurts, habits, and hang-ups and offenses with you wherever you go. Because wherever you are, there you'll be. Amen? Let me tell you, hurt people hurt people. You just bring your issues with you. Unfortunately, that's what happens. But not here at Parkview. We want to bring every pain, every hurt, every habit, every hang-up to the altar of the Lord so God can heal us with his presence. He can heal us through his word. He can heal us with the balm of Gilead. And so what happens is folks want to, they transfer their wounds to everybody else who will come into agreement with their offense. Come on. And these emotional wounds left unchecked force a person to withdraw from healthy, Christ-centered relationships. And that's where the devil wants them, insulated and isolated, so they can't be in a church family and understand the love of Christ. Amen? The Bible says our weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds, casting down thoughts and imaginations, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. The devil wants to build a stronghold in your thought life. The Bible says you need to get a hold of those strongholds, bag them, tag them, and check them at the altar of Jesus Christ. Let me teach you something today about how to overcome, how to overcome these strongholds. The Bible says in, you guys can see that? The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, we are a body, a soul, and a spirit, a trichotomy. Let me show it to you this way. You're a body. Inside your body is your soul, and then your spirit, right? Body, soul, and then spirit. Paul says we are a vessel or a container. That's the body. The soul, what's in your soul is your mind, your thought life, your will, the choices you make, and your emotions. That's in your soul. If you're not born again, you are operating from the soulish realm. Your mind, your will, the choices you make, and your emotions are all receive information from the flesh. But when you are born again, the Bible says that the same spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead lives and reigns in your mortal body. Jesus said to Nicodemus in John 3:13-14, he said, you got to be born again. He says, how am I going to go back into my mother's womb? Jesus said, no. He says, you must be born of the Spirit. When you accept Christ and repent and ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins, and you ask him to come into your life and be your Lord and Savior, your spirit becomes born again. The Holy Spirit is deposited inside of you. Now you have a God frame of reference that you're going to be operating by the Spirit and not by the flesh. But you have to feed the Spirit, the Word of God, worship and prayer. I don't go to bed at night and do, oh God, by the power of osmosis, teach me your word. Implant your word in my mind. No, it doesn't work that way. You can't even go to bed with the Bible on your heart and say, oh God, transform my heart. No, you got to break open the bread of life and in your mind. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your. This is how you will know what is good and true, by the renewing of your mind. You ever see someone whose mind is all, they make bad choices and you go, and their emotions, they bring you on the roller coaster with them, and they're born again. Why? Why? Because they're operating from the soul. You need new software. The antivirus software. And they store up all the hurts. You never ever find someone with the checklist? You know what he did to me in 1979? It's like, man, this guy's, he's keeping emotional checklist notes of all the hurts. Back in my old church, you know what they did to me? I'm like, you. You got to bring that baggage to the altar. You got to be healed. Jesus, though, he wants you free. He wants you healed. He wants you well. He wants you to convert that into a ministry toolbox so you can help others who are going through the same thing. See, your pain is your greatest ministry. Oh, help me, Jesus. Holy Spirit. I counseled a woman 15 years ago. I was a young pastor. And she was telling me how she had an abortion. And she was weeping and crying, and I just didn't want to say the wrong thing or do anything wrong. We got into the conversation. About a half hour later, I said, when did this take place? She said, 32 years ago. I thought, you've been living with that pain for 32 years. Jesus has come not only to save you, dear, but to set you free from your past hurts, habits, and hang-ups. Allow the balm of Gilead to come into your spirit and to heal your soul of everything that has fractured and wounded you so you can move forward. She says, it's ruined 2 marriages. It's ruined my relationship with the kids. And I said, the devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. God's word began to heal her soul. We applied it to that wound, and suddenly God, it was like antibiotic ointment on the infection. It began to go away, and she said the wound had sabotaged 20 years of her life, but I reminded her that it would not affect the next 20 years because she bagged it, she tagged it, and she checked it on the altar. She converted her pain into her greatest ministry with Jesus Christ. Now she helps other people process their pain as they move along in their relationship with Christ Jesus. Amen. What about this baggage that we have? Right? 30% of the men in the church are struggling with pornography. 30%. 6% of pastors are struggling with pornography. Guys, we need to get healed. We don't want to pass this stuff on to our kids because you're embedding it in your DNA. Let me tell you, you need to get this junk to the altar of the Lord. The Bible says that that spirit of Delilah in Judges chapter 15, the Bible says Delilah sat in the lap of Samson and she took his long hair and put a web around it. You know, come on, where's the old church folks? Remember you had to put a bun in your hair? Come on. You put a bun? And what did you put through the bun to hold it in place? So you had a web and a web and a pin. A web site and a pin number. She said she got into his head with a web and a pin. It's the same spirit that's working in our culture today. You got to log on through the web and punch. Come on. You don't get this in any other church. I'm just telling you. All right, let's close it up because I know. Last one. What about this stuff? It's not alcohol. It's balsamic. Yeah, it's balsamic vinegar. I've learned prescription medication. We have a problem in our country. Whether it's the doctors or the pharmaceutical company. So here's what happens. We refuse to deal with all of this. I got all this baggage, I got all this hurt, I got family baggage, I got financial baggage. I'm saved, but my life's a mess. I got all this baggage, and I'm hurting so bad on the inside, and I'm born again. And the only way for me to deal with this is to medicate it with this. So I turn to pills, I turn to alcohol to medicate the pain that's going, and you're born again. You see, this problem turns into another problem if we don't deal with the root cause of the problem and let Jesus heal us. See, he doesn't just want us saved and our name in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's great. That's a part of it. But God wants you free. He wants you healed. He wants to sign you up on the world's greatest evangelistic team. Why am I telling you this? Because my prayer is that we will have a Franklin Graham crusade down at the college. That's my prayer. And we will see thousands of people saved. And they're going to come into the church with this stuff. Hey, somebody told me I could find Jesus here. And we got to be real careful we don't run them out. Oh no, Pastor, he's got problems. We all had problems. God saves us to heal us and set us free. God said he'll send the whosoever to Delaware, to Maryland, to Pennsylvania. Why am I telling you this? Because folks, we got to be positioned in our heart for the greatest harvest, as Jordan said, the greatest harvest. You're going to go to school with kids that you know, they might have problems and they're going to need to see the love of Jesus in you. They're going to need to see the compassion of Christ in you. They're going to need to know that you've hidden God's word in your heart and you're able to minister to them and share the gospel with them and invite them to youth group or whatever it takes. Because a transformed heart is a powerful heart. Me? God did a miracle in my life 20 some odd years ago. I lost count. It's so long. Praise God. He took all my junk from the past and he healed me. I haven't picked up a drink or a drug in 20 some odd years. For me, it was instantaneous. One encounter with the resurrected Christ, I laid it all down. I gave it all to him, and I ran to the cross like it was the fast food, the line at the smorgasbord, because I couldn't get away from all of this quick enough. It destroyed everything I known. And then I met Christ at the foot of the cross, and I said, Jesus, I give it all to you. Break every chain. Break every chain, Lord. Take away all the addictions. Take away all this stuff. Oh, Lord, how are you going to fix my financial baggage? He done it. He done it immediately. Some things took a little bit of time. He worked out my salvation. I had to cooperate with the Holy Spirit. I couldn't go, no, ain't nothing wrong with me. Nothing wrong with me. Jesus said, just bring it to me. Listen, Jesus is the greatest TSA agent you'll ever know. He knows what's in here already. He doesn't need to put it through the machine. He doesn't need for you to take off your sneakers and take off your shoes and put it through the machine. He doesn't need your iPhone and everything put in the line and so it goes through. He already knows what's in here. He already knows. And he's saying, would you just bring it to me and so I can heal you and set you free? I don't want you saved. I want you free. But that's a choice you got to make. I can't make it for you. I can't do it for you. It's a personal relationship with Jesus. If you don't have that personal relationship, God wants you to know him in a deep and meaningful way today. He's saying, would you come to me? You know, I created you. You have a purpose in your life and in your heart. I love you with an everlasting love. I love you so much. I sent my son to the cross to die for your sins. But you're not only saved, but God wants you to be free and say, Jesus, I want to be free. Will you stand to your feet with me today? Hallelujah. Anything you need to bring him today. Anything. Don't leave carrying this stuff and saying, oh Lord, my heart is so heavy. If there's anything that you need to bring to him today, I'm going to count to three and I want you to come to the altar. I want you to leave here different from when you came in. Even if it's the smallest thing, even if it's something from your childhood, from your past, something you feel it's in your heart that you've been carrying around, you want to say, Lord, I want to give it to you today, and I don't want to look back. I want to take hold of that for which you took hold of me. I want to forget the past. I want to grab hold of tomorrow, and I want to let go of yesterday. If that's you, I want to meet you down here at the altar. 1, 2, 3. I want you to come down. I want you to come down. I want you to come down if that's you. God has a plan for your life. You got to let go. Just let go. Just let go. He's got a plan. He's got a plan for your life. He's got a plan for your life. He's got a plan. It's saying, let go. 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 Check your baggage. Check your baggage. Check your baggage. Check your baggage. You don't need to carry it anymore. You don't need to carry it anymore. Just let it go. Put your hand on the baggage. Let it go. Let it go. Just put your hand there. Put your hand on the baggage. Say, let it go. Go ahead. Just say, let it go. 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 Let go of yesterday. Let go of all the pain. Let him heal you. Let him heal you of all the pain. Some of it, it's relational pain. Some of it goes back to your childhood. You were abandoned. You had only a mom or you only had a dad. God saying, it doesn't matter. I'm your father today. I'm going to heal you of that abandonment. You have an orphan spirit. You keep roaming around and not being able to settle down. God is going to heal that orphan spirit today. So you don't have to be a stranger. You don't have to roam around. God is supernaturally healing that wound in your soul today. You're no longer a slave to fear. You're a child of God. Come into agreement with what God says that he has for you.